My name is Carla, and this is my friend Laverne and Shirley for real, and we're here to check out The View!
It's Wednesday, October 21st, coming up live on The View. They're the hottest topics on television. From the latest TV personality caught cheating with a coworker, to whether an MTV reality show led to DJ AM's fatal overdose, to why Dancing with the Stars was even more of a thriller than usual last night. Plus, Glenn Close and her sister Jessie are sharing their family's personal battle with mental illness and showing you how they've teamed up with Ron Howard and John Mayer to shed light on a disease a lot of people don't understand. And Modern Family stars Eric Stone Street and Jesse Tyler Ferguson are revealing which one TiVo's The View every day and which one's sex life has been turned upside down since the show became a hit. All that, hot topics, and more, coming up live on The View.
Really good. All of you look really
Thanks
good today.
So do you.
That is fabulous.
So do you look good.
I love that.
You like that?
I love that. I do. Your breasts look amazing.
And it's Christmas come early. It's the velour.
Yeah, it's a little out of sync.
That's okay.
Oh, it looks great.
Come here, you.
No.
Special.
You know, Glenn Close is here today. Yeah. And yes. And, of course, she was unforgettable in Fatal Attraction. Mm-hmm. And today's New York Post has a story that may remind a lot of people of that movie. Now, the 22-year-old former mistress and co-worker of ESPN analyst Steve Phillips wrote a letter to Steve's wife, stating she was tired of sneaking around about their affair, and included intimate details of the Phillips family's private life. She even mentioned the birthmark on Steve's...
Crunch.
You know,
crunch.
Crunch-ay. He says she's obsessive and delusional, but admits he slept with her, you know, like 3 times. Now, I'm sorry. When you write a letter to somebody's wife, you are looking, and in the letter, this is my favorite line, I'm not writing this to hurt you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What are you writing it for? You are writing this letter to hurt, maim, destroy the marriage.
Well, it's kind of the typical story, right, of the woman who she was, they were allegedly having this affair. He said it was only 3 times. Mm-hmm. He was traveling somewhere, supposedly to California. Mm-hmm. She wanted to go or something. She wanted to see him one last time after he was trying to cut things off. And he said no, so she's ticked. She also then
cut a few things off.
Yeah, maybe. Allegedly, she was getting in touch with their 16-year-old son, which I find the most creepy, online, pretexting is what it's called, posing as an adult or as a teenager. I'm sorry, posing as a minor.
Right.
Talking to him, hey, are your parents talking? She gathered so much information about their family, which she then used in a letter like this and other incidences, supposedly, against them, which I find incredibly creepy that it seeped into the kids.
Elizabeth, not only that, this letter, she showed up at the home and put the letter in the door. So when the wife came home with their 7-year-old son, this girl was in the driveway, and it scared the wife.
So she banged into something?
She banged into the stone column at their home because she was trying to get away. And then she kept texting the son.
Yeah.
But
she really read the whole thing.
But what I was going to say is that, you know, this brings us to that question that Sherry and I always talk about. You know, when you have a serial messer around her, you know, a guy who is constantly fooling with other women, this can't come as a surprise. I must say the wife now is filed for divorce because I think this one was too crazy. But
he settled a lawsuit, a sexual harassment suit previously with the co-worker. You do think at some point, when is the wife going to say, I'm picking up my own self-esteem for my own sanity, and I got to get out of this mess. But, you know, for me, I go, this is what he gets. Because you know, it wasn't worth it. Was it worth it with the little 22-year-old?
The first 3,000 times he did it was probably worth it. But I think
but
this one probably.
But what it it's affected your entire family, the safety of your family, your children.
That's why his wife is saying no more.
Well, we're talking about him. Because whose face, here's my problem a lot of the time. Whose face do you see? I mean, yeah, she's done some things that were incredibly outside the lines, okay? Like foul play, going to the house, writing the letters, texting the son, et cetera, allegedly. But we see her face all over the place. And it's always the woman's face that we see, always the mistress. And now I think that if we can focus on the man and still hold him culpable for the things.
His face is all over the place.
We tend to blame, don't you think, though, that we put a scarlet letter more on the woman than the man? And they can kind of carry on with their lives?
If you do this and you do it privately, when I get pissed off is when you send your letter to the New York Post. When you post, when you start taking your business and putting it and giving it to people and say, put this out because it's salacious, then I have an issue. Sure. Because if you want to get this man or do whatever, you know, we talked about this yesterday. You cannot, when a guy says to you, this is why I said, I don't mess with it until I know they're done. When a guy says to you, it's done, it's done. Walk away.
But that's a lot of times a guy doesn't do that.
Crazy.
A man will say it's done, and he'll tell the woman it's done, but yet you're still going back home to your wife.
So can I say something about the woman?
I'm talking about their affair.
This woman, this crazy woman who wrote this letter, she would be very good to go to a psychodrama session. Because in a psychodrama session, you would write that letter in the session and never mail it.
Right.
But because she actually sent the stupid letter, she's wrecked a marriage, a career, and a car.
But you remember Glenn Close, but you remember in Fatal Attraction.
It's a triple whammy.
I'm sorry,
Glenn Close, I remember. You remember when that rabbit was in the pot? Yeah. Glenn Close scared the crap out of me. Wow. She was crazy.
Yeah, I have to tell you that affairs fell to a new low years after that movie. Because the truth is, you don't know.
Who you're getting.
You don't know who you're getting.
See, they should play this. They should play this for married couples before they go and give the I do's,
I think.
Maybe it should be part of premarital counseling,
Wouldn't you rather deal with the crazy wife you know about rather than that crazy woman that you get that you didn't know was crazy? Sex might be good.
That is really some choice.
But maybe people make peculiar choices.
And identifying his genitalia did not work for Paula Jones, and it's not working for this crazy bitch either.
Well, you know, there's just some information I don't think people need to have. No. Like, I don't think the Post needed to tell me where his birthmarks were.
But like you said, it's salacious.
It's salacious.
Salacious.
Too much.
Salacious.
Salacious. Salacious. Delicious.
Speaking of salacious, Balloon Boy dad Richard Heaney has been getting beaten down by the media, painting him as a publicity-obsessed, angry UFO nut. But is his wife, Mayumi, getting off too easy? Here's some of the 911 call that she made. Take a listen.
We can find the 60-year-old Falky, and my other son said Falky was at the bottom of the flying saucer. He said he was in there, but anyway, I can't find him anywhere.
Okay, so we're gonna get you help.
And the Oscar goes to.
But you know it's a total acting job. But the 911 dispatcher kind of got into it with her. Was it a flying saucer? I mean, who's working at these jobs?
I must say, out in Arizona and places that have big sky, it is not unusual to see odd things flying around. So I'm just saying, maybe that, you know, both of them have seen this UFO. You can't, like, dismiss it.
I have a hard time, though, because I do feel I kind of go back and forth with this woman because I wonder, you know, after seeing the clips of this guy on, what was it, Wife Swap or something, and seeing that sort of like violent edge to him, was there a point in the relationship?
She was violent also.
Right, but
she had anger issues too.
Maybe.
Let's not dismiss that.
Right, but I'm saying I do at some point, I float between holding her culpable for what's going on because I do think obviously she's an adult playing a part and also being under. Is she under the control of this man?
Well,
and
know,
what fear does she have for the safety of her children
sometimes,
outside of all of this?
I don't know, you've heard about these stories where you've had these men who were killers and they always had the woman next to them who helped bring in... I mean, even with the case of Duggar, you remember the wife was... I don't know if they were charging her or not, but you always hear these...
The kidnapped kids.
Duggars.
Not the Duggars. You can't confuse them. That's the family with 100 children.
I just need to leave with the words.
The Duggars have all of their children in place.
All of 92. Dugard. Yeah,
right. I love the
But
Dugard.
You hear of these girlfriends or these wives who are, they've been controlled.
Yeah, like Nahida Nussbaum. Remember that case?
Yes, that was crazy.
And she, she might have believed it. I don't know if she did, though, because I saw her on Wife Swap. She's a whack job.
Here's the crazy thing. It must be true that for every man, there is somebody.
Yeah.
It may not be true for women, because how do you go to jail and marry a murderer?
You know,
that would have a little, because you don't know, they might get out on some weird thing, and there you are sleeping next to him. Are you like this?
You don't know. Are you sleeping like this? Look at people.
That's dangerous, and also let them clap.
Now go.
I was just going to say, it's just as dangerous to me to sleep with a plastic surgeon. I don't know what he's going to do either. That's all I was going to say.
Take out a scalpel and enlarge your breasts.
You never know. You never know.
Okay, well, you know what? We're going to go and come right back with more people to sleep with.
How'd it go?
Oh, yeah. This is recording.
Julia was very good. I mean, she...
Bill, not so much.
They were very lively. Man, it's a...
it's a fun show.
It's a fun show.
I'm going to stay there for hours.
Oh, my God, it was amazing. But the best part about it for me, Whoopi Goldberg. I've been wanting to see Miss Whoopi for so long. I almost bombarded her when I went out there.
No, when Joy said this was the best macaroni she's ever eaten.
And she kept eating it. She's like, forget this. I'm not for doing the show anymore.
Incredible.
I'm just
eating. Incredible.
The best.
Wait, tomorrow, Olympian Natalie Coughlin, booted from Dancing with the Stars, is going to be with us. It's going to be with us tomorrow. I just wanted to let y'all know that.
Yeah.
But getting back to the real stuff, newlyweds Khloe Kardashian and NBA star Lamar Odom have hammered out their prenup. She's not entitled to his $33 million contract with the Lakers, but he is putting money in a joint account every month. And she will receive a lump sum for each year that they're married.
Like an incentive. Almost like a basketball contract.
To keep her married.
What am I doing wrong here?
Where do you find these people?
I don't know.
What people?
But I'm saying a person
that will put a lump sum
into your account every month.
On a basketball court. Go find one.
Who will pay for a luxury home for you.
You really want that,
NBA.
Jen?
Do I really want it?
Do you want
it some? It sounds so good, though, doesn't it?
She wanted
what she wanted was $500,000 for every year they were married. I don't think she got that. Per cheek. She wanted $25,000 a month in general support, a new house, a new luxury vehicle at the end of every lease cycle.
Is she going to work with him or is she married to him?
I don't know. She wanted $5,000 a month for shopping, $1,000 for beauty care, and courtside Laker tickets for everybody in her family. You tell me that don't sound good.
No.
No, it sounds like a slavery deal to me.
No, it sounds like a hooker to me.
How about those vows, though? I mean, nothing in there mentions fidelity, companionship.
No, it's because this is a money deal, and I'm sure that they don't. I'm sure they don't see it this way. And you know, I have to say, getting married without a prenup these days is dumb. It's just dumb.
For anybody?
For anybody.
I didn't believe it at first.
If you're both broke?
I would do it.
Yeah. I don't know.
Because a prenup prevents someone. Here's what happens. Here's why I think that it's foolish. Okay. You and I get married.
Okay.
We have a great relationship. It goes on for a long time. Then I slip. You get mad. You say, you know what? I'm out of here. Not only am I out of here, because you're not mad at me for anything else that I broke I broke our vows.
Right.
But you're going to try to take me and cause me as much pain as possible.
Sure.
This is, so.
But if we get married in California, I just get half and it's easy,
you think it's easy. It's not easy for the person who's got to give it. And also, the small print on those prenups are movable. They're fluid. So sometimes in California, you think it means one thing, and then they explain to you that, oh, no, that's not what that means.
Outside of having...
That means they get more.
Outside of having kids, isn't it sort of a... I don't know.
Isn't it
dooming? Like, don't you think it's going to be over and you're already planning for the defeat of the marriage? Without protecting kids.
It's almost like, insurance, car insurance or something.
It is insurance.
I mean, you're hoping that both parties fall in love, stay in love, and nobody's going to freak out.
Yeah, but you know what? Nobody's got a crystal ball here. No one knows what's going to happen in 10, 15 years, even 2 years.
When we started, I was with you. I did not believe in prenuptial agreements. Going through
Let's
a lot
do that,
of,
huh?
Yeah, I do now. Going through, but if I got with somebody now, I have a 4-year-old son, and I want to protect that for my son.
That I get.
When you go through a very nasty divorce and stuff like that, it tends to change.
Because people change during a divorce, and it doesn't even matter if you have kids, because whatever you have.
Yeah.
And that maybe you liked or you brought into the marriage. It's like, you know what? I'm taking your stuff so you know how angry I am with you. See,
things get ugly.
They get bizarre. They get bizarre. And even if you have nothing, Joy, it's not about the money sometimes. It's about whatever you have that you care about, I'm taking it.
And is it a weeding out process for some? I'd imagine that, say, for this couple, the one with the $33 million contract, maybe it's a weeding out. Like, okay, if you're willing to agree to these things, then I know you're not after me just because of my contract, right?
That's so, in a way. She has her own money. She's got a very successful, they got two reality shows.
Why does he need to put money into their, why aren't they both putting money into that account?
Well,
so Mace Moore wants to go and buy some stuff.
I think it's protecting his stuff.
And he is no fool. And as I mentioned, Olympic swimmer Natalie Coughlin was voted off Dancing with the Stars last night. But she'll be dancing on The View tomorrow. The highlights of last night's show for me, and I know this is going to come as a shock, I actually saw Dancing with the Stars yesterday. I didn't watch the whole thing. I happened to come home, and they were doing this magnificent tribute to Michael Jackson. Please look at this.
When you actually see the pros
when you see dancers dance, it is just, it's thrilling. And when they're doing it in sync, that's what made Thriller such a great music video. When you see, no one is out of place. No. Everything is moving simultaneously, succinctly. It's brilliant. I love great dancers. And we'll go and come back and we'll have more Hot Topics. That's what I'm sure of.
Woke up at 8 o'clock, but we were late for school, rushing to get my son dressed, dragging him down the block, get to school. There's no school today.
Last year, Grace. We had her out at a playground and having a good time, and then we went to a birthday party, and then I got a call from her teacher, who I had never met, saying, "Hey, where's Grace? It's the first day of school." "Oh, really? It's the first day of school? And she's not there." Super mom. Missed the first day of school.
I'm really torn between telling that story you just told, which is really funny, and telling you this, but I better stick to this. Carrie Prejean, you know, suing the Miss California organization, claiming she was unfairly stripped of her title because of her anti-gay marriage stance. And she's being countersued by the Miss America people. Miss Universe people, for a breach of contract. Good God.
You should have told my story.
The story is still in my head, and it's hysterical. But Carrie Prejean, she's being sued for failure to do public appearances and not repaying the money that they loaned her for her breast implants.
So they want them back. This is really a case of tit for tat, okay? If ever there was one, this is it.
Wait a a minute. If you give breast implants.
I'm sorry. Yes, it's the Miss California organization that she's suing. Well, you know, I'm a stickler for trying to get it right.
California, not the universe, right?
When you get the breast implants, do they say you have to pay us back?
The fact that they give them to you. It's almost like giving steroids to athletes. I mean, you then have a bump up.
Hang on a minute. Wait, time out. What about all the plastic surgery that's on TV and movies and actors and people who are around? Doesn't that give them a bump up?
Y'all are not in contact.
I'm just saying, like, you got to understand. This is, I don't know what sort of agreements they have about body parts and enhancements and all of that, but I don't even think that, aside from the money...
Because they're not even expensive now. You can get boobs for like $22.
It's not the question of people coming into the thing with the breast implants or their plastic surgery. They're paying for it. They shouldn't be paying.
That's the whole thing. Okay, so like when I used to go, but that's why the organization is suing. Because like when I was there and I went and I did a whole thing to be Miss California, they said to me, they said, do you want some new breasts? And I was like, yeah, but I don't have any money, you know? And like, I can afford one.
Just one breast.
The idea that someone is offering you breasts to get into a beauty contest. The beauty contest is about how beautiful you are.
It's about money.
Have you ever seen
it's about money.
The irony of the whole thing is that she was she offended the gay community.
Right.
So when they take the breast implants, she's going to look like a gay man. I love that. I think that is justice.
Don't you think she was slightly unfairly attacked for her stance? She had it. This is America, right? You're supposed to be able to have an opinion, okay?
She was
held to a standard that if she had another opinion, this wouldn't be applying to her. So that's where I do have some sympathy.
I don't know that they would not be suing her to get the breast back if she didn't do the job that she was supposed to do, which is you're supposed to make the appearances and do the stuff that you're supposed to do. But I do think...
Whoopi, I just wanted to say she's going to be on the show November 10th, Carrie Prejean.
That was my thing.
Never mind.
And I don't know what the point was, but now I've lost it, so it's okay.
We don't have that much of an issue with her as much as they gave them to her.
That's a lot of pressure.
So she can still come on.
Because they didn't give them to her. They basically said, this is what you need.
Well, when you're supposed to be a natural beauty. That's what it's supposed to be.
Have there ever been
small-breasted, regular-breasted, natural beauty folks who actually were trying to get that crown. But now, everybody's here. Everything is her.
That's right.
And we'll be right back.
Everybody looks alike.
Yes, they do. We'll be right back with Glenn Close and her sister, Jessie Close.
Super Tease time again. I am here with all the producers. See them? Good. Lily Tomlin.
Lily Tomlin's coming on to talk about a new show and if she's going back to Desperate Housewives.
And we'll have the next couple eliminated from Dancing with the Stars.
Martha Stewart.
Domestic diva Martha Stewart is throwing a Halloween party. It should be very spooky and over-the-top fabulous.
Mad Men star Elizabeth Moss is coming on to talk about her hit show, what it was like working with Whoopi a few years ago in a movie, and what she thinks of her fiancé's portrayal of Joy on Saturday Night Live.
So what?
Star of the hit show Damages, but she's here today with her sister Jessie to open up about something a lot of families deal with in private. Please welcome Glenn Close and her sister Jessie Close.
To ask you, as the queen of Fatal Attraction, do you have any advice for that lunatic that wrote that letter?
Probably go get help.
Go get help, yeah.
Yeah, I actually was sent a book by a doctor saying that he uses that character to teach his students about what a borderline personality is.
Yeah.
Which is highly incurable, borderline personalities.
It's very tricky.
Very dangerous if you're fooling around on your loved one.
Is there something for the husband to know that, you know, this is a borderline, or maybe I should stay away from her? Because Michael Douglas did not get it at first because he was in lust.
Yeah. Right. Well,
I wasn't paying attention because it was clear that something was off about her.
How about I'm married? Stay away from her. How about that? I'm married. Stay away from her.
Don't wait until you're a lot of guys, and you know.
No, I just be careful. I mean, people still come up to me and say, "Boy, you scared me," and man, it was good for my marriage.
Lynn, thank you for coming on, you and Jesse. And you do want to come on and talk to something that's very near and dear to your heart. Can you tell us what it is?
Yes. Well, today is the national launch of a campaign against stigma for mental illness called Bring Change to Mind. And and it started because we have mental illness in our family. I've seen the suffering. And I've seen what stigma does and how costly it is. And so we have the backing of every major mental health organization in this country. And we've established a portal, bringchangetomind.org, where you can get any help you need and any information you need.
Wow, that's cool.
And you don't have to be ashamed.
Jesse, I'm sorry.
No, we just want to talk about it.
Yeah. Yes.
Just talk about it.
Get the stigma.
This is something that is so shocking because you suffer from bipolar disorder back when you were a teenager, but you didn't get diagnosed with anything until you were 47.
I wasn't properly diagnosed. There were many doctors who put me on antidepressants, which can be very dangerous when you're bipolar because it makes you very manic. If you don't have something else in
there. So for about 30 years, you went around not knowing what was going on. You said you felt clueless.
You said you were nuts.
I was nuts.
So what did you think was wrong with you? This whole time of, I don't even know what this would feel like with nobody giving you a proper diagnosis for three decades.
I don't know what I didn't. I just behaved. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just controlled by my illness, and I had no idea what were some of the symptoms of what you had when you were...
Mania?
Yes. We don't go to sleep. you can be... Well, one kind of secret symptom is you can be over-sexual. Mm. I went through quite a few husbands.
Yeah.
Really? I bought and sold many, many houses.
Wow, this trying to sound a lot more like me.
It was always something else, you know, something else.
What did you think it was,
Glenn? I
think
we were thinking maybe Whoopi is bipolar. Because
she described her.
She buys real estate like crazy and marries over and over again.
Used to.
Changed your mind.
Well, the amazing thing is we just didn't have a vocabulary for it in our family.
Yeah.
You know, you find out later that there were other people in our family. You know, my grandmother was seriously depressed, you know, and we never, she was just always lying down.
Oh,
yes.
Yes, and there, that's... Can you get tested for the, are there certain genes they're testing now?
This is what's fantastic about what's going on in research. They now are knowing more and more about the genetic causes of mental illness. But it will take a lot of research. It's a very broad spectrum that has to be.
But it didn't hit you, Glenn. I'm assuming.
Well, I pour it all into my profession.
you and Jesse, you guys did a public service announcement for Bring Change to Mind, which was directed by Ron Howard. Why did you do this? Can you tell us about this PSA?
I did it for the very simple reason that I've experienced what it means in my family. Mm-hmm. And I really believe, I have this vision that someday we will talk as openly and without fear about mental illness as we do now about cancer and about diet. Part of the human condition, conservatively, one out of six people is affected by mental illness. So,
a copy of the clip. Let's show it right now.
One in six adults has a mental illness.
And we face a stigma that can be as painful as the disease itself.
Change a mind about mental illness, and you can change a life.
Say what you need to say. Say what you need to say.
what is the one thing that you want our audience to understand about mental illness?
I want the whole audience to understand that you are not your illness. Mm-hmm. You can get help. You should get help. You don't need to be embarrassed.
You get treated. Your symptoms are treatable, and you can have a full and productive life. Jessie's a writer. She's a mom. She's done it. But you have to get the right meds, the right balance, and it is possible.
And you have to be willing to live with some side effects.
Lynn, yeah. Jessie, thank you so much for coming and shedding some light on this. Yeah. A lot of people don't like to talk about it. Yeah. For more information on anything we just talked about, check out our website. And we're going to be right back with Modern Family stars Eric Stone Street and Jessie Tyler Ferguson.
I'm Bill Getty. YouTube has been taking you behind the curtain and showing you what happens around here before, during, and after the show.
I have to tell you, one of the funniest new shows this season is Modern Family, honey. Yes. This show just is one of the best written shows I've ever seen. Eric Stone Street and Jessie Tyler Ferguson star as a couple who can bicker with the best of them. Take a look.
I don't like football.
You know what? I thought part of being in a relationship was pretending to enjoy your partner's interests. Do you think I really loved home pickle making?
Yeah, because you did.
For a week, until we became the weird guys who gave everybody pickles. Oh, thank you, Marvin, for inviting us into your lovely home. Here, would you care for a sack of pickles?
Yeah, it was charming.
We were picklers, Mitchell. Okay, you know what? Fine. Stay home with your little jagged scissors. Maybe catch up on your scrapbooking.
You love scrapbooking.
Did I, Mitchell? Did I?
No, stop. Don't do the double question to prove a point thing. I hate it when people do that.
Do you, Mitchell? Do you?
Please welcome Jessie Tyler Ferguson and Eric Stone Street. She robbed me of my kiss.
I'll kiss you after.
Kiss her now.
I'll kiss him after.
No, kiss it. Do it now.
Well, these are hard.
Yeah, they're hard.
Pieces of cheese.
I was really worried what they would feel like.
Yeah, Eric watched the show to see how people were sitting.
We like to keep you alert.
Jessie, yes. Is this true that you DVR the show every day?
Every day. I've been with it since, you know, the Debbie days.
Right.
Oh, yeah. The Debbie days.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
I do fast forward over like the which swimsuit's best for your like body type part.
Yeah. But me too.
I'm clear on it. I know. No bikinis. I can't do the two-piece.
No, me either.
No.
But now listen, you play a gay couple who just adopted an infant from Vietnam. This is the first time a network show has showed two gay men raising an infant. The issue of gay couples adopting an infant is still very controversial, and I know, Jessie, this is a storyline that's very important to you.
Yes. I actually have an Asian baby in real life. Mm-hmm. I'm kidding. no, I'm a professional active gay man.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What's a professional active
gay man?
Well,
let me tell you. I practice it regularly.
I am openly straight.
You're openly straight.
Yeah, and as a matter of fact, Eric, you thought that you were hoping that doing the show, which is so hysterically funny, that you would get a date since you're single, but what's been going on?
Well, you know, everybody tells you, oh, you're going to be on TV, girls are going to be lining up, you know, whatever. And I've had some people lining up, but...
Not girls?
Mostly big, burly men. Yeah.
Women here.
You do. This is a gorgeous New York women. This is my first time to New York, and I have to say the women in New York are very beautiful.
But you know, I read that you wanted to be a warden in a prison when you were growing up. You'd usually hear firemen. You never hear warden in a prison.
Well, you know, I grew up in Kansas City, and right outside of Kansas City is Leavenworth, Kansas, and there's a lot of prisons there. So it was just a reference that I had. I always drove by fascinated. My dad's business was in Leavenworth, so I always saw it, and I thought, well, if I could just get inside there on the good side, that would be a great career. So yeah, I went to college to study sociology and criminal justice until a girlfriend broke up with me and I did a play and that was that.
You've
been doing this, what, for 13 years
now? Yeah, I've been an actor for 13 years.
We actually did some digging and found a clip of you early on. Check it out.
What's that? Mm-hmm.
You guys got your season tickets? I do, because I'm a fan. A big fan. Go, Cats! Go, Cats! I just want to say, Purple Pride! Go! Jerry Barnett! I'm your number one fan! That's wonderful.
I know that's
That was my first audition ever as a professional actor, and I joke around and say, I walked in to the audition, and they said, Eric, do you mind taking off your top? And I said, so it's true, the casting couch really exists? And I got the job.
Jesse, why do you still have three names? I just to clear that up for a second.
I have kept the Ferguson so that the bastards made fun of me in high school know who I am.
Oh. Yeah. Have you gone back to your high school reunion yet?
Yes.
Was it going back to your high school reunion?
When I went back to my high school reunion, I hadn't done very much of anything. I'd done some theater, and I had like a commercial running. But even that, back in Albuquerque, New Mexico, an Olive Garden commercial, that buys you a lot of credit. Yeah.
Wait till you go back now. Because you were a gay boy?
Maybe a little bit, yeah. I mean... Yeah. You know.
This has been your love since you were eight, right?
I've been doing this for a long time, yeah. Not the acting thing, not the gay thing.
Got it. Now, Jesse, Halloween is coming up.
Yes.
We've already been talking about our Halloween costumes. Right. But we hear that you want to dress up as Lady Gaga.
Listen, I mean, come on, did you see the VMAs?
Yes.
I mean, the opening outfit on the red carpet was amazing. Was amazing.
Yes.
There
amazing.
She is, yes.
Yeah,
and then she blows my mind with this, like, coconut donut thing. I mean, what is going
fabulous.
On? What is that even?
It looks
and then,
good.
And then, like, this is, like, Tim Gunn took her to Mood and, like, didn't advise her on what fabric to pick. And it's just, like, she's a gay... lacy Spider-Man.
I just like
that's the one I'm going with.
I like that's an option that I could start going to things dressed like that. Like, why couldn't I just go with a mask in front
of me?
Thank you, Lady Gaga. Thank you.
Well, listen, I hear there's going to be a lot of guest stars on this show because this is one of those shows that everybody is now talking about. Mm-hmm. So can you talk about any of the folks that are going to be on?
Well, we just had Shelley Long on playing my mother.
Wow.
Shelley
Long.
Yes. Shelley Long.
Cheers.
She's so funny.
We have Edward Norton that's going to be on the show. The same episode with Elizabeth Banks.
Is he funny, Edward Norton?
He
is. He's a great actor.
He's an incredible actor. And the part that they wrote for him is really funny. Uh-huh. So.
Yeah. All right, well, maybe there's going to be some black people soon.
Hey, Modern Family airs tonight.
I don't know what the story's going to be on that.
Okay, that's tonight, right tonight on ABC. We're going to be right back. Why y'all doing that? You scared me. Tell you that it was a great show, but if you have not watched that show, it's fantastic. I love it. Listen, everybody, take a little time to enjoy, I don't know, your view, our view, any view. Bye.